Worship, and therefore this becomes a place of worship and a holy place because we're gathered here before God to ask for His blessings on Emily Elizabeth Smith and on Austin Trey Miller and their vows and their marriage today. I want to share just a moment about the covenant of marriage, because covenant is a word we don't use a lot. It's a great word. It's a great biblical word. It means a contract. It means a coming together of two or more parties to make a contract agreeing on promises and stipulations, privileges and responsibilities. That's what we've gathered here to do today. Austin and Emily enter into the covenant of marriage one with another. In Genesis chapter 2, God said it's not good for man to be alone. I'm not sure at what point Austin came to that realization, Sometime around the time when he met Emily, and some point during their 6 years of being together, he understood, I need to be with her. Jesus said in John chapter 15, he said, apart from me, you can do nothing. Wasn't speaking about marriage, but it's included there. And so for all of us to be mindful today that with Jesus Christ as our God, as our Savior, as our Lord, then we can do all things, and certainly we can do marriage. In fact, Paul said and wrote in Philippians chapter 4, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So the two of you and all who are married, who are going to get married, remember that God meant for us to get married, man and woman. He meant for us to cleave and leave. He meant for us to do all things together with Him. So I want us to pray together now. Would you bow? Our Father in heaven, we thank you that wherever we are, and more importantly, wherever you are, when we gather for the purpose of worship, we enter into your presence. And so now, in this beautiful, incredible chapel, Father, we do gather for a time of worship. I thank you for Austin and for his life. I thank you for, Lord, the sparkle in his eye when he looks at Emily. I've seen it. Most all of us in the room have. And Father, I thank you for his salvation and for his faith in you. That faith will serve him well in the years ahead as Emily's husband. Father, I thank you for Emily and the gleam in her eye when she looks at Austin, and for her salvation and the faith that she's placed in Jesus Christ, her Lord and Savior. And so together in these moments, as they join their lives together before you and before all who are gathered here, a time of worship, we ask your blessings on their union. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And who gives Emily to be married to Austin?
Her mother and I.
Very good, Mr. Keith. Yes, sir. Thank you. You may be seated, sir. And Emily, won't you hand Caitlin your bouquet? Very good. Y'all can turn and face each other. Be fine. Go ahead. Look, move closer and hold hands. There you go. So when I shared with Austin and Emily, we met together on the coast, and I shared with them about Ephesians 5. And I don't know if you're familiar with Ephesians 5 or not, but beginning of verse 21 and moving forward, there's just amazing verses that give great direction for husbands and wives in marriage. Eugene Peterson has written a paraphrase of the entire Bible, but this section of Scripture stands out for me. And so what I've done is I've kind of written a paraphrase of the paraphrase, but I've included Austin and Emily's names so that it becomes a personal challenge for them. So if you're married, and I'm reading their names today in this Scripture passage, just be mindful of your role as husband and wife. Austin and Emily, out of respect for Christ, be courteously reverent to one another. Emily, understand and support Austin in ways that show your support for Christ. Austin, you're to provide leadership to Emily the way Christ does to his church. Not by domineering, but by cherishing. Just as the church submits to Christ as he exercises such leadership. Emily, you should likewise submit to Austin. Austin, go all out in your love for Emily, exactly as Christ did for you and as he did for the church. A love marked by giving, not getting. Christ's love makes the church whole. His words evoke her beauty. Everything he does and says is designed to bring the best out of her, dressing her in dazzling white silk radiant with holiness. And that is how you, Austin, are to love Emily. And then Paul, as he wrote this, and Eugene Peterson, as he paraphrased it, is a wonderful promise here. Austin, you're really doing yourself a favor since you're becoming one in marriage. What is clearest to me is the way Christ preached the church, and this provides, Peterson put a good picture, but I think it's a perfect picture of how you, Austin, are to treat Emily, loving yourself and loving her, and how you, Emily, are to honor Austin. Austin and Emily, I require and charge you both, as you stand in the presence of God, before whom the secrets of all of our hearts are disclosed, that having duly considered the holy covenant you are about to make, you do now declare before me your continued pledge of faith. Be well assured that if these solemn vows that you exchange today are kept as God's word demands, and if you endeavor to do them, the will of your Heavenly Father, God will bless your marriage. He will grant you fulfillment in it, and He will establish your home in peace. So now it's the time to exchange vows of the covenant. So Austin, you repeat these words to Emily. I, Austin, take you, Emily, to be my wife this day and every day, to have and to hold, for better, for worse, for richer, for poor, in sickness or in health, to love and to cherish until death parts us. For the glory of God, I pledge you my faithfulness. Very good. And now, Emily, you to Austin. I, Emily, take you, Austin, to be my husband this day and every day, to have and to hold forever, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish until death separates us. For the glory of God, I pledge you my faithfulness. The ring holds a very noble place in the traditions of marriage. Its circular shape testifies to your unending love for one another, and oh, by the way, God's unending love for you. The metal, the precious metal, bears witness to the purity of love. So wear your ring. Austin, this is more for you than it is for Emily, right? You know, if you have to resize it one day, brother, go spend the money, get it resized. So wear your ring. Always wear your ring, both of you. Be proud of what it stands for. Let it remind you of the vows that you're committing to today. And remember that when you accept it today, you're becoming identified as belonging to one another. And this really is the only, other than the marriage license, this is the symbol that stands for that union of your lives together. Your ring being worn in your ring, being worn a gift from each other to the other. So, Eddie, do you have? Okay. And then Kate. Very good. Austin, if you'll take the ring you have for Emily and place it on the ring finger of her left hand, she'll show you where. Yes. Just hold it right there. He's obviously received good instructions. Just hold it right there. I want you to hold it there. Now, there are some brief phrases to repeat to Emily. Ready? To her. Emily with the ring. I pledge my life and love to you with all I am and have. I give myself to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now put that all the way you did. All right, now put the other back on there so it's complete. That is beautiful. And now, Emily, your ring for Austin, if you'll put that on the ring finger of his left hand. Yep. And just go ahead and put it all the way on. Look, we're not going to play games here. All right, there it is. Now, just hold it there. I want you to hold it there. Ready? Now, you say these words to him. Austin, with this ring, I pledge my life and love to you with all I am and have. I give myself to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, couples decide in their wedding ceremony to do various things to symbolize their union. And Austin and Emily have committed to share this moment in this ceremony by bringing together the pieces of a cross that we're going to call the Unity Cross. It will be a beautiful sculpture that they will display in their home. Anytime you look at it or anyone who comes to visit, they'll be reminded of the covenant you're making here today. It's literally a three-part covenant, not just a two-part covenant between the two of you. But you're making it between each other and between the Lord Jesus Christ. So through this covenant and from this moment forward, you will be united together forever in your journey of life. I love the journey that you've been on, by the way. It's pretty phenomenal. Senior, junior proms, and then together to proms, and then proposal at the waterfall. If you haven't read Emily's testimony on their wedding page, you need to go read that. I wish there was video, and there may be, but I haven't seen it, of Austin on his knee, scooting up to get closer to her as she walked away from him towards the water. You couldn't have a more beautiful picture of his love for her than that moment. And what a beautiful picture it is. And so the cross now becomes a picture of even that moment, a reflection of that moment, but and your journey together to this point, but your journey beyond as well. In Genesis chapter 1, we find that God created man in his own image, Austin. It means that you were created to be bold and strong and a leader and a protector of Emily and your family. The outer form of the cross that you will place in just a minute represents strength and leadership and protection that you bring to Emily. So, Austin, if you would, take this outer piece, and if you just place it. Yeah, that's beautiful. Just like that. Now, in Genesis chapter 2, we learn that the woman was taken out of the man, from the man. And this piece, Emily, your piece, if you'll just hold it just for a moment, represents your beauty and your capacity and the giftedness that God has placed in you. And when you place it inside the cross, it is a beautiful picture of your joining your life together with Austin. So if you would, go ahead and put it together. And symbolizes the union of your life, the becoming one together. Now, from here we move on because this, as I said a moment ago, is a covenant between the two of you and the Lord Jesus Christ. And fly here. You take one. I'll put the hole on the side and just can you just push it in there? You'll have to move the cross around a little bit. Oh, it's just so incredibly beautiful. And then here, and it's symbolic of the Lord at the top of the cross. Austin, help me get it. Yeah. There we go. The scripture tells us about the cord and that it's not easily broken. We also find in Matthew 19 that a man will leave his mother and father and be united to his wife, and the two will become one. And therefore, what God has joined is joined together today in your lives. Let no one separate that from you, one from the other. In Jeremiah in chapter 1, we learn that God knew you both before you were born. And in chapter 29, he tells us that he has a plan for your life. That plan obviously includes coming together today and joining your lives together. May this cross forever be a reminder of together in communion and what God has planned for you. Now just make and let now would you bow with me as we pray? Father in heaven, I thank you so much for Austin. Lord, I can remember when he was knee-high to a grasshopper, and now he's become such a great man. And you have blessed him these 6 years in dating Emily and courting her and pursuing her. And Father, our prayer here today is that their covenant, Lord, is one that you have blessed, are blessing, and Father will forever bless. Give each of them a long life's journey together as a married couple, exactly what they need in the moment. Lord, whether it be right words or whether it be silence or whether it be the right plan or decision, Father, guide them forward in their married life together. Bring people into their lives that will help them and encourage them and become partners with them. Father, bless them in every way. For your glory, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me slip back just a little bit. So by the authority of God's word, the love of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit, I now pronounce you husband and wife. You may kiss and seal your vows. Thank you. to stay for the reception. I've checked it out. It looks amazing. And I'm telling you, the flower girl and the ring bearer, best I've ever seen in any wedding.